The RoxAnne Tauriello Show takes you inside prison and jails as men reveal lives of sin and consequences. Hear God's amazing message of hope. Listen to the testimony of the infamous David Berkowitz and celebrities like Jerome Hines and Melba Moore, to athletes Marvis Frazier and Charles Way, to Dr. D. James Kennedy and Joe Douglas. The RoxAnne Tauriello Show, where you'll find out how to receive from God forgiveness, a brand new life, and eternal life.
I'm RoxAnne Tauriello, and welcome. His name is Gary Cuozzo, one-time pro football quarterback with the Baltimore Colts and Minnesota Vikings, and he'll be joining us today, and he'll be talking about his days in the NFL, his own personal life, and how he came to repentance and faith in Jesus Christ, receiving him as his own personal Lord and Savior. And we'll be right back.
The RoxAnne Tauriello Show takes you inside prison and jails as men reveal lives of sin and consequences. Hear God's amazing message of hope. Listen to the testimony of the infamous David Berkowitz and celebrities like Jerome Hines and Melba Moore, to athletes Marvis Frazier and Charles Way, to Dr. D. James Kennedy and Joe Douglas. The RoxAnne Tauriello Show, where you'll find out how to receive from God forgiveness, a brand new life, and eternal life.
Welcome back, and joining us is Gary Cuozzo, originally a quarterback with the Baltimore Colts and Minnesota Vikings. Gary, it's a pleasure having you on the program. Before we talk about your days in the NFL, tell us, what was Gary Cuozzo like as a child growing up?
Well, as a child growing up, I was basically the kind of kid that when he was told to do something, I pretty much did it. I'm sure I had desires not to do it, but I kind of was an obedient kid, and very, you know, church going regularly, didn't miss church, and I just tried to excel in things I did, just from the fact that I was driven to do well in sports and academics. That's just the way I was. I never understood why, but I was always trying hard.
Now, Gary, you know how youngsters have certain dreams of what they want to be when they grow up. Was there ever a special time in your childhood when you said, I want to be a football star?
Well, not exactly a football star, but I wanted to be an athlete. I always wanted to play. I was a basketball player as well as a football player, and baseball, and did it all. And I just always liked to play ball. My mom used to say I was ball crazy, but I love playing sports from the time I was very little.
Again, when you were very, very young, concerning football, was there ever a specific time, a specific game, as a child now, when you said, wow, I could really do this great?
Well, it probably happened in high school, where I decided I thought I wanted to play college. And then when I was in college, I went to a professional football game, and I realized that I thought I could play professional football. Mm-hmm. It just seemed like each level that I reached, I thought maybe I could go to the next level. I never really decided that that was enough for me. I just wanted to keep playing.
Mm-hmm. Now, the years go by, and you excel in your education, and you play pro football with the Baltimore Colts as a quarterback. What was the most exciting season for you?
Probably the most exciting season I ever had was actually with the Minnesota Vikings. Mm-hmm. I had an opportunity to start the season after we got upset by them in the Super Bowl, the fourth Super Bowl in Kansas City upset us. And the next year I came back. I didn't start in the Super Bowl the year before, but we opened against Kansas City in the opening game and beat them. And then we went on to win our division, and I played 12 straight games before I got hurt that year, and then got into the playoffs. We lost in the playoffs. That's probably the most exciting season I had, is when I was with the Vikings.
What's that? Let me just ask you quickly. What's that like, being in the Super Bowl?
The Super Bowl itself, it's a lot of preliminary hoopla, which makes you think it's going to be more than a football game. Mm-hmm. And when you get out there and realize it's just a football game, you wish you had thought of that beforehand, because we did get beat. And it takes a lot away during the week with all the press and all the people that descend upon a Super Bowl. In fact, we were the last game that they ever had a one-week break between the last season game and the Super Bowl. From our game on, they went to 2 weeks, which is a much better idea, because it gave more time for preparation.
Mm-hmm. there was a time when you had 5 touchdowns. Could you tell us about that?
Well, when I was playing with Baltimore, I backed up John Unitas back in 1965, was mm-hmm. my third year, and Unitas had never been injured for 3 years. Mm-hmm. Then he got injured. We were playing the Vikings in Minneapolis, and he was injured enough where he couldn't play that day, and then I got the opportunity to start, and I set a record for the Baltimore Colts, and it was a opportunity to be NFL Player of the Week and all that kind of thing. I did have a 5-touchdown pass game. And it was just, that was probably the highlight of my career as far as it happened to be the first game I played in as a starter.
Now, a couple of weeks later, John Unitas, a Hall of Famer, the greatest quarterback of all pro football, gets hurt and you fill in for him.
Yeah, 2 weeks after that game, Unitas got hurt again and we were playing the Bears, and we lost that game, which I played half of, and then the following week we played the Green Bay Packers, and in that game I made it through about the second quarter and got my shoulder separated mm-hmm. and had to they had to have another quarterback named Tom Matty, who was a halfback, come in and take my place, and we didn't win that game, but we came close. If we'd have won that game, we'd have gone to the first Super Bowl, because that was 1965. So it was very disappointing for me. And I, 3 weeks earlier, having been NFL Player of the Week and being a great star, and then finding myself 3 weeks later in the hospital with a shoulder separation, and it was a big difference.
So let me gather this together now. Prior to being in the hospital, you had set a record, 5 touchdown passes in 1 game. You're NFL Player of the Week. The publicity, the calls. You then fill in for John Unitas and you get hurt and you wind up in the hospital. Mm-hmm. Tell us, what happens?
Well, I think it put life in perspective real quickly for a young guy, and all the accolades, and I had a listed phone number and people calling me, and then to be in the hospital with a separated shoulder, and the team goes on to play the Rams, and I was in the hospital and didn't get to go out to LA to play in that game, and didn't have any visitors, and very few people care anymore, which is what you realize life is about. It's you. It's kind of like David Robinson, the present day basketball player, saying that every time you win a championship, it's like a high jumper. You have to fail at the end because you can only jump so high, and the championships with a basketball player, if they win one, they say, are you going to win it again next year? They just mm-hmm. keep raising the standard, and for an athlete, so you become frustrated, realizing that the praises of the world and the accolades of man mm-hmm. are very meaningless, because when you have them 1 week, next week you're being booed, and so you just start to realize that if you're not playing this thing to glorify God, you're really wasting your time, and also building a false basis for life.
Yes. You said that the Lord began to bring Bible believers into your life, and so during training camp, your roommate was Raymond Berry, a Hall of Famer, wide receiver. Mm-hmm. What was Raymond Berry like?
Well, Raymond was different than anybody else on the team.
Really?
And the way that, he had a Bible, carried it with him all the time, and, in camp and on the road.
Not to the team meeting, but
in his room and on road mm-hmm. trips, he always had his Bible, and mm-hmm. it was underlined, multicolored, and
really?
All different, I'm sure all the different verses and the different books and the epistles and things, and at the time, I'd had a Bible, growing up in my home, but I'd never really read the Bible very much. I was basically a church-going kind of mm-hmm. believer, not really understanding the scriptures, but I knew who Jesus was, and I knew what Jesus had done at mm-hmm. the cross, but I had never appropriated it personally for me. I really was still striving and working hard to be the best I could be, to be the best church-goer, the best, mm-hmm. all that kind of the works mentality mm-hmm. that the Bible speaks that are not
that
worth too much.
That cannot save, yeah. cannot give you eternal
much,
life, no.
Filthy rags, I believe they're called.
All our righteousnesses are as filthy rags in the sight of God. Well, in 1967, you were traded from the Colts to the New Orleans Saints, and God brought into your life Carol Dale of the world champion Green Bay Packers. What was he like?
Well, Carol was similar to Raymond. They both called themselves Christians, mm-hmm. which I really didn't understand the differentiation mm-hmm. at the time. And during that period of time, I was actually in a summer camp when I met Carol Dale. He didn't play with the Saints, he played with the Packers. And I was just impressed again, once more, with a Christian man mm-hmm. that was different. He seemed to have peace, more peace than others had. He had priorities different. It wasn't all based on wins and losses and championships and stardom and not the world system, you know.
Mm-hmm. Which of the two gentlemen that we spoke about, the two football players, was the one who began witnessing to you when you were in the shower?
Well, that was,
he began
that was,
talking to
yeah.
you, you're in the shower, you can't
right.
go anywhere, and he begins
well,
witnessing.
That was Raymond.
Who was that?
Raymond was.
What exactly, what happened?
Well, he'd been very patient with me, and you know, I was interested in what he was doing, you know, with his Bible, and mm-hmm. he had Bible studies with some other fellows on the team, but I was basically just going to church regularly, mm-hmm. And so I'd asked him.
Never read the Bible, nothing
no,
to the Bible.
No,
you were just a churchgoer,
yeah.
not knowledgeable about the Word
no,
of God.
And no. And so then I asked him about it, you know, and he just started talking. And we were in the shower. It was everybody had left, and we had been studying films. And he kept talking, and I was getting uncomfortable because I didn't really follow when the shower water was running. My mm-hmm. fingers were shriveling up, and I wish I'd never asked him a question. You know,
and he just kept on talking about Jesus Christ. And who was this again now?
That was Raymond Berry.
It was
yeah.
Raymond. And do you remember things he was saying?
No, I really don't. I don't think.
But you just marvel that here you're in the shower, and he's just continually talking about Christ,
yeah.
and you had nowhere to go. You had to just stand there and listen.
Pretty much, yeah.
Now, we were talking about Carol Dale, and you said that the Lord used Carol Dale to minister to you and your wife during a difficult time in your life.
Well, that summer I got traded to the Saints. My wife was pregnant with our second child. And our first child had German measles, so my wife was exposed to German measles. Doctors recommended we have an abortion. And I got involved in a prayer circle that night, which I'd never been in before. I'd never prayed publicly with anybody else. Mm-hmm. My prayers were always very private. And we're in a gymnasium, and it came around my turn in the prayer circle. And I realized there was something different about my relationship with God and theirs. And afterwards, I stayed and talked to Carol Dale and talked to lengths about this idea of understanding who Jesus was as personal savior of your mm-hmm. life, as well as the fact I shared with them this problem I had with my second child being exposed to germ measles. Yeah. And he said, Gary, I'll pray for you. And that was in June. And he went to play with the Packers, and I went with the Saints that year. And the season was over. I was back in Memphis in dental school, and we got a phone call from Carol Dale. And my wife got the phone call, and he asked how the baby was. He'd been praying for 6 months.
Really?
And it just impressed me that somebody that said they would pray really did pray. I always thought that people just sometimes said that when you told them something that happened mm-hmm. to you bad, and then they say, we'll pray for you, and I don't know if they really meant it. Well, he meant it. So it influenced me to realize that I wanted to find out what was in this book, this Bible, that they mm-hmm. spoke of, because I met two men that called themselves Christians. They lived by this book. They had more peace than I had in my life, and I wanted to know what it was about. Mm-hmm. And so from that point on, God started to work in my life to make me understand salvation by grace.
Mm-hmm. So I just said, Raymond Berry, Carol Dale, these guys were different.
Very much so. Yeah.
They were different. They not only, as you say, they not only read the Bible, opened the Bible, but they believed the Bible, and out of love for God, their Savior, they lived it. I mean, they were really different.
Yeah, they were living testimonies.
Now, at the Fellowship of Christian Athletes Camp, you began to really have a hunger for the Word of God.
Well, after the experience of Carol praying for me, I started to God just seemed to open my eyes.
You saw a difference in Carol Dale than even in yourself?
Oh, yeah.
What was the difference? Can you?
Well, their desire to do what God wanted to do through what the Bible said.
Did you see that? You saw that in their everyday life?
Yeah,
how about even when they were playing football? Was there a difference even
on the field?
What was the difference on the field?
Well, it'd be more or less they weren't connected to the game mentally. If winning lost wasn't that critical. I mean, they mm-hmm. played hard as they could.
Yes.
Yet losing wasn't like the end of the world to some people, you know. And that's how I think a non-Christian becomes, because they're basing their system and their life on the values of the world.
Mm-hmm. But these men, whether they lost
or
won, they felt that they were
they give everything they can, and that's all you can do. Raymond mm-hmm. told me that one time. He said you just have to learn to have a smoother, if you're going to play pro ball or any level of ball, you have to maintain a smoother personality in terms of mm-hmm. what your emotional level will be. You can't rise and fall so much. You have to be steady, and only God can do that. You can't do that emotionally, because in the flesh you get so excited with good things, and you get so depressed with bad things.
But there was a steady peace, no mm-hmm. matter what happened during a certain game. There was a peace about them. They were just doing the best they could for their Lord and Savior. Now you come and you open the Word of God, mm-hmm. and what do you begin to find out that surprises you?
I've really thought about that a lot, because I don't exactly remember details, but I do know that it had to be verses that were impacting on the difference between my life mm-hmm. and what the Scripture said. Mm-hmm. The Scripture said, "For by grace are you saved through faith. It's not of yourselves. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." And I was doing works. And I looked at that verse, and it would be contrary to salvation that I was experiencing. I thought salvation was a combination of Jesus plus what I had to do, mm-hmm. not realizing that when you get to heaven, it's not a matter of reading a resume to God. It's what Jesus did at the cross. Is all mm-hmm. sufficient. And appropriating that from my life made an entire difference. Now that it's time, is I go to church because I want to go to church, not because I have to go to church. Mm-hmm. I want to serve God because I want to serve God, not because I have to serve
God. So by reading the Bible, you found out things like, for all have sinned, fall short of the glory of God. Every person is a sinner. You can't get to heaven by good works, good deeds, or anything else that you could possibly do. Yeah. But that the one way to heaven is through the all-sufficient, one-time, perfect work of Jesus Christ upon the cross.
That's what I discovered.
Or if we could get to heaven by good works and good deeds, then God would have never had to come in the
exactly.
flesh and die upon a cross. And these things began to become aware to you mm-hmm. through reading
the
Word of God. About 7 years ago, you had a tragedy that happened in your life. You lost your son. Your son was murdered.
Mm-hmm.
Knowing the Lord Jesus Christ, knowing the Word of God, knowing Jesus Christ as your own personal Savior, how did that make a difference during this terrible time of your life?
I think when you faced what we on earth still face, tragedies, you realize that when you realize that Jesus Christ, when he's all you have, you realize he's all you need. And mm-hmm. during that period of time, I got very depressed. Depressed of my, to the point of despairing my own life. In Romans, the 5th chapter, it talks about God using these things, to glory in these tribulations. It's very hard to do that when you're in the middle of it. And the Romans verse also about all things work together for good. At that time, I didn't understand that. But I can see that God has used this in my life to make me realize that he is everything and that he is sovereign. And I prayed the night I went to identify Chip's body that I would be reassured of his salvation. And God answered that prayer with letters that I found, my children found in his room, and it just attested to how much he trusted in Jesus, and I had an assurance that he had eternal life. And I prayed that God would use his life, and God has used his life through my family and my life, realizing that I've really kind of come to the end of myself. I think until a man is broken and greatly broken, sometimes you can't be used completely by God. And I really feel that I have my purpose to be served on earth is to, as I am here today, just to be with you, to share this gospel of Jesus Christ, because it is the only way. It's the way, the truth, and the life. And we carry a message here today, Roxanne, out to this that is, it's everything. And I think we handle it so lightly sometimes. I mean, this is eternity. This is heaven and hell. And yet, we may do TV shows, we may talk, we may go, but this is everything.
Yes,
this is everything that your TV viewers need to know about why they are here and where they are going.
Yes.
It's the only truth.
Yes, and I know that you go out today and you minister to young people in schools and churches. And I praise God for that. And Dr. Gary Cuozzo, I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for joining us today and for being so open with your testimony. And thank you
thank
for
you,
the
Roxanne.
Man of God that you are today. Hear my cry, O God. Attend to my prayer. From the end of the earth, I will cry to you when my heart is overwhelmed. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I, for you have been a shelter for me and a strong tower from the enemy. I will abide in your tabernacle forever. I will trust in the shelter of your wings. Today, through God's love, grace, and mercy, the Spirit of God wants to lead you to the rock, that being Jesus Christ, who is God the Savior, a sure foundation, and his desire is to forgive you of your sins. His desire is to have a personal relationship with you and to cleanse you and open the door once again to a relationship where he will direct your life in holiness and righteousness and walk with you down the path of life and carry you through the storms of life. And he wants to give you peace, joy, purpose, and life eternal, never to face judgment and hell. If you want to receive from God forgiveness of sin, a personal relationship with him, and life eternal, here's what you must do. You need to repent. You need to acknowledge your sin with a desire to turn away from a lifestyle of sin. You need to believe that Jesus Christ was and is God the Son, and that upon the cross he loved you so much that he took God's wrath, the punishment and penalty due to you and your sins. He died, was buried, but on the third day rose again from the dead. And the very moment you're willing to come to God with sorrow for sin and a desire to turn away from a lifestyle of sin, believing that Jesus Christ was and is God the Son, and that he took the punishment and penalty for you, died, was buried, and rose again. Upon repentance and faith, God will forgive your sins, past, present, and future. You will have a personal relationship with him and eternal life in heaven.
For New Testament Bible, free and postage paid, call 1-888-679-4709. 1-888-679-4709. And thank you. Go to www.roxanneshow.tv. Find out about other cable systems we air on. Then click on TV On Demand. See our shows online 24/7. Also check our cable TV schedule, future guests and times. Learn about our ministries in Africa and in jails and prisons. It's www.roxanneshow.tv.